I mentioned last week that I'm wanting to play a song at the beginning of every week because a lot of worship music comes from Revelation, and so I thought I wanted to give a feel of that by playing a song and then having the verses up. And this one, so we're going to start chapter one, and this one is only a part of the song, but it comes from chapter one, so I want to include it. So this is, I'm going to play once I get, depending on the technical situation. It's a recording from North Boulevard Church of Christ of Days of Elijah, which technically also this part is combining parts from Daniel and Thessalonians, but anyways, you'll see how the first bit of the chorus comes from Revelation as well.
These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sword, still we are the voice in the desert, crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, so lift your voice as the year of Jubilee. Servant David rebuilding a temple of praise. And these are the days of the harvest. The fields are as wide in your world. And we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. Trumpet call, so lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, so lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. So lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee, and God of Zion's hill salvation comes.
Okay. So that was song time, and I'm now going to wrap up what I was talking about last week, which was Old Testament prophecies that are important to Revelation. And it's a good segue into starting chapter one. And so going back to the very beginning, which I talked about this more last week, but again, the promise to Abraham about Israel was all peoples on earth will be blessed through you. And then to Daniel 7, which we read the whole thing because it's alluded to so much in Revelation, but this is part that is alluded to big time, including chapter 1, but and this is a prophecy that, I'll just read. In my vision at night I looked, and there before me was one like a son of man coming with the clouds of heaven. He approached the Ancient of Days and was led into his presence. He was given authority, glory, and sovereign power. All nations and peoples of every language worshipped him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that will not pass away, and his kingdom is one that will never be destroyed. And so this was written during the exile of the Jews, and so a good bit of the Jews had been sent after Babylon destroyed Jerusalem, were sent just across the empire and were fighting to survive and not assimilate. And there had been a big period starting with the exile that lasted a long time of different ways that they were persecuted. And Daniel talks about the kingdoms persecuting them as beasts, but says that the message given to Abraham, which is restated all throughout the Old Testament, that Israel will bless all the nations of the earth, would be fulfilled, and that the Son of Man figure, who is the Savior figure of Israel, would lead them in a kingdom that is obviously more than just a human kingdom, but a spiritually empowered one as well, where heaven and earth, the kingdom, are one. And so far, Israel was filled with failure. That was the reason they were exiled and persecuted. Israel had gone through cycles of failing to live up to the prophecies and promises of who they were meant to be. But Daniel 7 has a very optimistic view. And so this ideal would be to be reached. Israel would need to change. And so we have prophecies like this of another verse. But so he asked me, "Son of man, can these bones live?" I said, "Sovereign Lord, you alone know." Then he said to me, "Prophesy to these bones and say to them, 'Dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the Sovereign Lord says to these bones. I will make breath enter you, and you will come to life. I will attach tendons to you and make flesh come upon you and cover you with skin. I will put breath in you, and you will come to life. Then you will know that I am the Lord. I will put my spirit in you, and you will live, and I will settle you in your own land. Then you will know that I, the Lord, have spoken, and I have done it, declares the Lord. And it shall come to pass afterwards that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams. And your young men shall see visions, even on the male and female servants. In those days I will pour out my spirit." So, again, last week I referenced the verses that Paul talks about, the mind of Christ, the ability to live up to your identity as God's people, which they weren't able to reach before the Spirit. And the Spirit prophecy is, you may remember, verbatim quoted in Acts 2, as Peter says that this is happening right here, and it's for you and your children and your children's children. So this prophecy is about us. And so the Christians saw all of the prophecies of the kingdom as beginning with this and with Christ's atonement, allowing them to be holy and have the Holy Spirit, and that the kingdom would grow on a wider scale and bless all nations as this merging of the spiritual and the human side. And so I wanted to, again, just because it's important. Oh, okay. Well, yeah, thought this was later, but this is very important to Revelation. So I'll read this, and it's also about what I just talked about. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. The he here is Jesus, speaking to the disciples after the resurrection. And he gave them this command: "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, the Holy Spirit, Then they gathered around him and asked him, "Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." And so, again, for the early Christians, it was really important to them, their belief that the prophecies of all the nations coming to acknowledge God as the one true God and the kingdom to grow as this bigger than ever kingdom with heaven and humanity merged. They saw all of this as beginning the process, and it was really important to them that it would be fulfilled because that's what they believed. And so Revelation is addressing the fact that with all this persecution, their faith in this happening has been called into doubt. But also, I just want to really say, remember that the way Jesus says the kingdom would spread to the ends of the earth is, "You will be my witnesses." And so I had a lot of verses that I flew through because I ran out of time last week. So now I'm going to just go through those and read them to help give a good picture of what's going on. So you see this a lot in the Psalms. I just picked two, but there's more. "All the nations you have made will come and worship before you, Lord. They will bring glory to your name. The Lord has made his salvation known and revealed his righteousness to the nations. He has remembered his love and faithfulness to Israel. All the ends of the earth have seen the salvation of our God. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. For behold, darkness will cover the earth, and deep darkness the peoples. But the Lord will rise upon you, and his glory will appear upon you. Nations will come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your rising. For I know their works and their thoughts, and the time is coming to gather all nations and tongues, and they shall come and shall see my glory. Thus says the Lord of hosts, it will yet be that peoples will come, even the inhabitants of many cities. The inhabitants of one will go to another, saying, 'Let us go at once to entreat the favor of the Lord, and to seek the Lord of hosts, I will also go.' So many peoples and mighty nations will come to seek the Lord of hosts in Jerusalem, and to entreat the favor of the Lord. Now it will come about that in the last days, the mountain of the house of the Lord will be established as the chief of the mountains, and will be raised above the hills, and all the nations will stream to it, and many peoples will come and say, 'Come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, that he may teach us concerning his ways, and that we may walk in his paths.' Do not harm the land or sea or trees until we put a seal on the foreheads of the servants of our God." Then I heard the number of those who were sealed, 144,000 from all the tribes of Israel. After this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. They were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands, and they cried out in a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God, who sits on the throne, and to the Lamb." And so, I've said a few times that Revelation is responding to the question, why are there so many martyrs? And knowing this does help understand it. And I haven't brought up yet, though, a concise answer, even though when we went over the message a couple weeks ago, we saw. But so before going into chapter one, I'm going to give just a concise answer that the text says. In the persecution, despite changing the prophecies, Revelation takes up the most optimistic of the Psalms and Old Testament prophets, and affirms the boldest, most hopeful form of Israel's and the Jewish faith, that all the nations of the world will come to know the one true God and become his people, And the central message of Revelation is the way this happens is by the Lamb's followers joining his faithful witness, witnessing and giving their testimony of the truth, even face to face with the ultimate evil, and even unto death. And like Jesus said, it starts with giving witnesses. And so this leads into Revelation 1. So let's just go through and have a chat about it. I'll start off just reading the whole chapter and then we can go little by little. All right. So, Revelation 1.
What version are you reading?
This is ESV, but it doesn't matter, whatever version. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants the things that must soon take place. He made it known by sending his angel to his servant John, who bore witness to the word of God and to the testimony of Jesus Christ, even to all that he saw. Blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy, and blessed are those who hear and who keeps what is written in it, for the time is near. John to the seven churches that are in Asia. Grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come, from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of kings on earth, to him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood, and made us a kingdom, priests to his God and Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Behold, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him, and all tribes of the earth will wail on account of him. Even so, amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. I, John, your brother and partner in the tribulation and the kingdom and the patient endurance that is in Jesus, was on an island called Patmos on account of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, and I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet, saying, write what you see in a book, and send it to the seven churches, to Ephesus, and to Smyrna, and to Pergamum, and to Thyatira, and to Sardis, and to Philadelphia, and to Laodicea. Then I turned to see the voice that was speaking to me, and on turning I saw seven golden lampstands, and in the midst of the lampstands one like a son of man, clothed with a long robe, with a golden sash around his chest. The hairs of his head were white like wool, like snow. His eyes were like a flame of fire. His feet were burnished bronze, refined in a furnace, and his voice was like the roar of many waters. In his right hand he held seven stars. From his mouth came a sharp two-edged sword, and his face was like the sun shining in full strength. When I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead, but he laid his right hand on me, saying, fear not, I am the first and the last and the living one. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore. I have the keys of death and Hades. Write therefore the things that you have seen, those that are and those that are to take place after this. As for the mystery of the seven stars you saw in my right hand and the seven golden lampstands, the seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands are the seven churches. Right in the beginning, we see one of the biggest themes. John, who bore witness to the word of God and to the testimony of Jesus Christ. And it's also interesting in that John's gospel has a very large theme of witnessing and testimony. And so just an interesting comparison that I thought was comparing the beginning of Revelation to the end of the gospel. So this is one of the last verses of John's gospel. This is the disciple who is bearing witness about these things and who has written these things, and we know that his testimony is true. So the importance of witnessing and testimony is front and center. And in verse 3, this is something I talked about the first week, but the New Testament books were read out loud. They weren't read privately. They would have been the church would have had the letter, and someone would stand up, read it start to finish in front of the congregation. And that's important because, again, we're reminded of this in verse 3. Blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy, and blessed are those who hear. And it's important because something I've tried to convey and will continue to try to convey is that Revelation was in no way meant to be confusing. It's in practically every way meant to be shocking, but not confusing. So its original audience, it would be very clear. And here we see it was obviously clear enough so that to a significant degree, you would understand it just listening to it start to finish. Although, of course, you would get more and more out of it the more you studied. But again, it's not a sealed book, so to speak, using a metaphor from the end of Revelation. But it is something that another point that I made is that when you hear the whole message, it makes a lot more sense. And that's why the second week I spent just doing an overview of the whole book and the message. Because when you focus on the message start to finish, it makes a lot more sense. And I use the example of the prodigal son. If you were to, and this is review, so if you want to hear more, go to Eugene Church of Christ YouTube page and Revelation Class 1. But anyways, so if you look at it and then think two sons, what did the two sons represent? What does the number two mean? And then put it down and pick it up and read inheritance and think, what's the inheritance represent? And then, you know, scratch your head over what this is supposed to be. You're sort of reading it the way it wasn't meant to be read. If you just read it and hear the message, then you know the inheritance is just a visual way of getting the message across, and it could be lots of things. And in the same way, when they heard it start to finish, and the message was what they were hearing, and the rest they saw as visuals enhancing it. And so that's why I spent a whole class just doing the message of the whole book rather than gradually getting to it week by week. And that's also why I have this handout, which is an overview of the whole book. But anyway, so here he says, blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy. So me, and blessed are those who hear. So you guys. For the time is near. And the time, something about the time is near. I'm going to read real quick just a sneak peek of next week. This is from chapter 2. Okay. This is talking about a false prophet whom Jesus is talking to, specifically the church in Thyatira. And he's talking about a false prophet whom he calls Jezebel. And this is chapter 2. Verse 22, behold, I will throw her onto a sickbed, and those who commit adultery with her, I will throw into great tribulation until they repent. And this is a random example of something that we see all throughout chapter 2 and 3, which is he's talking about very much the present for these churches and by implication for us. So when he says the time is near, he's talking about the present and the future in a way that John and Jesus, who gave more literally, I suppose, Jesus, who gave the revelation to John, does something important in the message where they blend the future and the present and the near future and the far future are all blended into this message. And it's because your future and the world's future and what you do now and the world's future are blended and interconnected and intertwined. And we only have a small window to live like Christ and share our testimony and witness Christ. And so going on 4 through 8, So 4 through 8, all this stuff I have bolded. This is John giving a personal greeting, saying that he wants grace and peace for his churches. But he's also setting up many, many things that will play a very important role. So in the following revelation and book, we see often the importance of God and Christ being the one who is and who was and who is to come. And we'll see from the seven spirits, which will be important later, and is a reference to the seven churches. And while I'm not going to get much into numerology or anything, because it's not really important, it's more of a flair that enhances it, I guess, and makes it more interesting, I will say real quick that seven was thought of as a number of completeness. So John's comfortable saying seven spirits, even though theologically, obviously, there's only one Holy Spirit. But it wasn't unusual to say seven spirits of seven churches. And even though there's one Holy Spirit, but it shows that it is again emphasizing the spiritual significance of what they do and how they are all bound together through the Spirit. And again, it's interesting that it's written to the seven spirits, but he says grace to you and peace from the seven spirits as well. So the same Holy Spirit giving the message is giving them peace and grace as well. So again, just going through before his throne, we'll see throughout the importance of Christ and the Lamb and his throne and the throne of God. And we'll see again more about the importance of witnessing. And Jesus here is using the title faithful witness and firstborn of the dead, which death and the resurrection are very important in the rest. And kings is an important theme. And Christ being the ruler of kings is important. And I could go through everything that I bolded, but Christ's blood, the people being made a kingdom of priests, Christ coming with the clouds, every eye will see him, even those who pierced him, all of the tribes of the earth mourning or wailing, the Alpha and the Omega, who is, who was, and is to come. All of these things will be very important through the rest. So John, right off the bat, is in one paragraph blending together a lot of really important themes. And he's also blending together a whole lot of Old Testament quotes and allusions. And so something that John's going to do throughout the book is he is giving almost one continuous string of Old Testament quotes and allusions. And it would take a very long time if I broke down each verse that John's referencing from the Old Testament, because it's practically continuous. His way of blending the Old Testament with his message is a strong affirmation of his authority and the message that these prophecies and God's word is faithful and will come true. And again, just its status as this is it. This is the climax of all prophecies. What John's prophecy is here. And so all of this, now we can get into some pictures. Oh, maybe. Oh, okay. We're not gonna get into some pictures. We're gonna do that a few slides from now. But here's just a verse that, so this is just one hymn that you see, if you look at it, just how many things from the first paragraph or the paragraph that we just looked at come back into this. And so this is just an example of a hymn that has all of these themes. Okay. And then, yeah, so while I'm not going through all of the Old Testament quotes to show you how many, I'm just gonna focus on this one verse, the three titles, Faithful Witness. First off, Psalm 89:35-7. Once for all, I have sworn by my holiness, I will not lie to David. His offspring shall endure forever, his throne as long as the sun before me. Like the moon, it shall be established forever. A faithful witness in the skies. Selah. See, I have made him a witness to the peoples, a ruler and commander of the peoples. And I will appoint him to be my firstborn, the most exalted of the kings of the earth. So in this one verse, John has blended three verses with even one title is blending two verses, the ruler of commander of peoples and the most exalted of kings of the earth. John blends into the ruler of kings on earth. And then again, the witness and the firstborn, which John reapplies to firstborn of the dead, which is a reference to Christ being resurrected first, and so firstborn of the dead, as the rest of us would be resurrected in the future. And so now we can get into some pictures. So 9 and 10, I, John, your brother and partner in the tribulation and the kingdom and the patient endurance that are in Jesus, was on the island called Patmos on account of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. So Patmos I have in bold because that's the island I have in the background. And so here's just to give a flavor of, if you went there today, what you'd see. First off, there it is on a map, and another map, it's towards the bottom in there. And then here's a map of the island today. Not really, I guess, super applicable to back then, but if you want to come today, now you know where the harbor is, so that's where you can put your steamboats. And here's the, just a nice collection. So, a pretty place and a town, you know, a big, lots of stuff to do. But at the time, the Aegean Sea, where the island is, was a place where Rome would send political prisoners. They would send them on islands as a sort of type of house arrest, except island arrest. And so when John says he's there on account of his testimony, it fits with what we know from the time, which is political prisoners were sent there. And John preaching about Jesus as king would lead to him being arrested in the same way that the many others were persecuted. So, I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet, saying, write what you see in a book and send it to the seven churches, to Ephesus and to Smyrna and to Pergamum and to Thyatira and to Sardis and to Philadelphia and to Laodicea. And real quick, There you go. That's where they are. And the order of the churches is actually the order of during that time the letters would have been delivered. So that's the ancient version of the mailman. That's the route he would have taken in that order. So now the description of Jesus, I'm going to try and do something that I want to do with all the visuals, which is pause and have a look at each thing. It's a really visual book, and when you just read it, you can just skim by, but I guess to show the shock and the awe of just what is being described, I want to just stop and try to imagine this image of what happens next. And so we'll look at it. I'm just going to read it just one little bit at a time to help us imagine. So John turns to see the voice speaking to him. Upon turning, John sees seven golden lampstands. In the midst of the lampstands is one like a son of man. The son of man is clothed with a long robe, a golden sash around his chest. Hairs of his head were white, like white wool, like snow. Eyes were like a flame of fire. Feet were like burnished bronze, refined in a furnace. Voice like the roar of many waters. In his right hand, holding seven stars. Coming out of his mouth, a sharp two-edged sword. His face like the sun, shining in full strength. So let's just take a second to appreciate this image. So this description of Jesus here that is going to be speaking to John now. He has a sword coming out of his mouth, and his eyes are like flames of fire, feet like burnished bronze, voice of a roar of many waters, hairs white like wool, like snow, a golden sash, a long robe, and in his right hand holding seven stars, and his face shining like the sun. And real quick, this description of Jesus is a very exalted one, as it's a reference to Daniel, in which the Son of Man goes and sits on the throne next to the Ancient of Days. But here, John has blended the Ancient of Days and the Son of Man. So the Son of Man's on the right. But on the left, the Ancient of Days is described as white as snow. The hair of his head was white like wool. So John's given Christ a very, very exalted status here by blending Christ and the image of the Ancient of Days. And so there's also a reference earlier to Zechariah that I want to point out now, which is God saying that when they look on me, on him who they have pierced, they shall mourn for him as one mourns for an only child and weep bitterly over him as one weeps over a firstborn. And so this is one that, again, John applies to Christ, which is the God of Israel speaking through the prophet Zechariah. And so here, Revelation, another theme is right off the bat, it has the most exalted images of Christ in the Bible. And this goes into John really doubling down on the authority of his message, but especially doubling down on the authority of Christ, as this is whom people were being martyred over, that their faith in him was being thrown into doubt and having to be confessed. And so Revelation has a prologue and an epilogue. And this image of the risen Christ begins the vision that is everything in between that occurred on Patmos on the Lord's Day. And so, looking at your outline, if you want, or I'll read it if not, but the last point I want to focus on is that there's a dramatic focus on the spiritual significance and component to each church and what they do. When I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead, but he laid his right hand on me, saying, "Fear not, I am the first and the last and the living one. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore. And I have the keys of death and Hades. Write therefore the things you have seen, those that are and those that are to take place after this. As for the mystery of the seven stars that you saw in my right hand, and the seven golden lampstands, the seven stars are the angels of the seven churches. The seven lampstands are the seven churches. You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden. Nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a stand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven." So I want to close with a thought. Well, close the PowerPoint section, at least with a thought, and then about just the seven lampstands, which Christ is in the midst of, which is in the battle of light and darkness, in societies of monsters coming from darkness. The church who is faithful overcomes the darkness with light, and Christ has won the battle already and conquers through the conversion of nations, redemption through his blood, the church giving its testimony. Jonathan Young. I can close in a prayer, but we have a little time. I didn't know if there would be extra time we could do this, but I've brought up several times just how interconnected Revelation is. Would anyone, this is a participation thing, if anyone would like to speak up. If we all want to look at chapter 22, so we just spent some time on the first chapter, and now if you want to look at chapter 22 and just skim through verse 6 to the end. Does anyone want to say if they notice anything that ties into the prologue, the first chapter we just read? Any just keywords or phrases or images that they notice are in both? I'll start in verse 13. "I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end."
How about verse 20?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, verse 20. "He who testifies to these things says, 'Surely I am coming soon. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus.'"
Anything. About 18.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Very similar to 1:3. "I warn everyone who hears the words of the prophecy of this book. If anyone adds to them, God will add to them the plagues described in this book." Mm-hmm. Yeah. Verse 8. Coming full circle. "I, John, am the one who heard and saw these things. And when I heard and saw them, I fell down to worship at the feet of the angel who showed them to me. But he said, 'You must not do that.'" But, yeah.
Verse 7.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, verse 7 and chapter 1, 3, practically verbatim, blessed is the one who keeps the words of the prophecy of this book. And even, behold, I am coming soon.
Phrase, the time is near. By that verse 10.
The time is near.
Verse 3.
So this is something that we're going to at some point take a break from chapter by chapter and focus just on looking at how interconnected Revelation is. And one of the clear ways that you see this is all of the ways it comes full circle with the epilogue and prologue. The epilogue really concluding and coming back to where it all began. And so we'll see a lot of that, but so that's actually one of my things that I really like to do whenever I teach a class is just try and find all these thoughts that appear a lot throughout the book and just look at the context. And so that's going to be something that we'll do, and we'll see some stuff that will make your jaw slam into the floor. So you can look forward to that, but I'm going to close with a prayer, and then we'll be good. Dear Lord, I pray that we do shine your light and that we are living up to just the name of Christian and your people. And I pray that through you and through our testimony, we can witness you and your light to the people around us and make a difference in the darkness that is here, but that your salvation and victory and redemption would come around us, and that you would work through us to be a part of your plan to make all things new. And we pray for encouragement, that we would encourage each other and be encouraged by you, and for us to stay optimistic as this book, Revelation, which closes the Bible, despite its shock, keeps its extreme optimism. And I pray that we would be optimistic and encouraged in maintaining your light and your love for us. And again, we just thank you for your word and all that you do for us and in our lives. And I pray be with us the rest of this week and next week too. In Jesus' name, amen.